Hi everyone, I'm Clive.
I'm Dan Fouché.
And I'm Louis Moran.
And today we're going to be talking about what is lean design through a few techniques, a couple of case studies, and then also some really key tips to get started. So first of all, we'll talk about lean design and lean design in our industry. Dan has been practicing lean forever.
A long time.
It's really interesting to see the difference between lean in construction and lean in design.
Because they are different, but they affect each other greatly. For instance, if a builder builds what's in the design, you can end up with something like this.
Not a pretty sight. So they might be on time and on budget, but are they actually what the customer was looking for? I think this is a few pretty comical examples of what actually has been constructed to plan as well.
Yes.
So the design process that we see, it's a linear process, is it not, Dan?
Aspirationally, it's a linear process. It's supposed to start with schematic design, and then at some point that's complete, and we launch into DD, and we're at 50% DD, by the way, the definition of which no one agrees on, and then we're at 95% DD. But actually, are we? The problem is the owner changes his mind. And we're back into rework. So we're starting over and we're looping but we've got a deadline to meet. So we finish DD and we move into the document phase. We got to rework again. And then we got to launch construction because we've already got a schedule.
There's a deadline.
Oh yeah. My God, but we still haven't finished design. isn't very linear. It's more like this.
Yeah, absolutely. So design is a crazy iterative process that goes round and round in loops that you can't really predict most of the time because of change, and that affects a lot of rework. And so it can be quite a complex process.
It kind of looks like me walking in the park, a spaghetti diagram of me walking in the park. The problem is the design manager or the contractor, if it's a design build, has put a line in the schedule that says that's DD, 50% is going to be done on September 24th, period.
Must be done, yep.
It's got to be done by then. And it's life isn't like that. It
one,
is not
one bar.
One bar.
One bar.
Yeah.
So not very useful to many people. So
no.
What is lean design? When we talk about design and when we apply lean, we hear lots of terms banded around. Can you unpack a couple of these?
Kaizen means improvement. BIM, you know all about, virtual design and construction. Scrums as a part of the process. Lean in design does not mean less design.
Perfect.
And that's the important distinction. It's creating value for customers while minimizing waste for the design team. Rather than redesign based on changes, it's a way to design with less waste.
Perfect. So understanding what the customer needs,
yep,
and really delivering that, not much else.
And understanding what the designers need so that we release work in a way that releases more work. And we design as information is needed. Many of you have seen 7 or 8 classic wastes. Rework is the big problem in design. In some cases, overproduction. Over-engineering is a problem. There are a lot of resources for it. You know, as you look at those books there, Clive, there's one that's missing.
Ah.
Oh, there it is.
Fantastic to have Dan on because he has just such a deep bench of knowledge about this subject. And we've worked together in the past on some really fantastic projects that have helped us understand how to improve and support that lean design methodology. So really, really pleased to have Dan on the team. There are lots of other groups around the world, and one of the biggest movements is the LCI.
Lean Construction Institute's founded in the late 90s and really kind of kicked into gear about 2010. Its annual congresses draw about 1,600 people into major ballrooms.
This was in Chicago.
Around the U.S., yeah. And there are LCI institutes in other parts of the world. Some of you may want to have one near you.
And so we talk about lean, we talk about design, and BIM is a big part of the two of those.
Yeah.
But so is BIM always lean?
What could go wrong? No. No, because BIM is a process as much as a product. And processes may or may not be lean. What we need to do is figure out what in our BIM management is wasteful and begin to stop doing that and start doing more valuable things.
So we've talked about lean in principle and the different terms used. Let's combine the two and start talking about what it is that we're attacking in the BIM workflow. So we've got 6 BIM wastes that we'd love to introduce. The first one is poor scoping. So really, how do you run a workflow that you have contracted for maybe an incorrect, overly detailed, overly generalized scope, it can be completely disastrous. Really difficult to understand what the customer wants if you're not able to clearly define it. So that's number one. Number two is the over and under production, as you mentioned there. So
yes.
Too much modeling at the wrong time can be really painful because that creates then wasteful rework.
Yeah.
And then what happens if the customer doesn't get looks for? They can't do their work. If it's a quantity takeoff and there's not enough BIM, then the quantities will be incorrect. And that workflow using a design model is really, really important. Another one here, Dan, which I really love. We've got one example on the left, which is costing us more money. They're both okay, are they not? They both solve the problem.
It requires good planning of the plan.
Right, to know what you're looking for and when. So the other one is waiting. If you've got a large model loading time on a poor hardware from a BIM perspective, that's waste. Yeah, you're waiting for something and that's wasteful. The deliverables, if you're waiting for something in order to do your work, then that can be waste.
Yeah.
Waiting for decisions.
Clive, you and I both have experience with projects where the people who are making decisions were not part of the planning process. So they didn't realize how much they can mess up your schedule, your design schedule, by not making a timely decision.
In order to understand what the handoff of information is, having an early plan and making sure that you communicate between the teams is really, really important. Yes. And then the perfect example for our industry with BIM is the clash detection, the coordination. If you build it once and it's trying to occupy the same space, you have to move something. And then this one here, administration waste. The problem here is that we really want to get on with what's important rather than spending time working on the administration burden. And so this guy is dealing with some administration burden that maybe he's not too pleased with. Maybe it's taking more time than he wanted.
His frustration is starting to show. Anybody ever do that? Anybody ever want to do that?
I have wanted to. I have wanted to many times.
I've never actually done it. Yeah. So there are companies out there who are doing a better job, who are improving on this.
Absolutely. And so we've talked about generally what lean is in design and then some of the waste that we want to attack. And now, Dan, we'll start to talk about phase planning and weekly work planning are two techniques that we can use to really drill into and understand how we can help the customer and make that process a lot leaner.
So phase planning operates at three levels. First of all, you milestone level, the strategic plan, the 30,000 foot plan. And you might think that means 50% DD, 95% DD, but there are probably some better milestones along the way. And they probably have to do with decisions that have to be made or approvals by a government agency that have to be made. And then there's the phase pull. The milestone pull, the strategic plan might be for the whole design sequence, but the phase pull might be for a much smaller chunk of work, a more manageable chunk of work. In construction, it's 2 to 4 months. In design, it may be, 2 to 4 weeks. It kind of depends on the speed of the design. And then once you have a phase pull, that means all the different steps involved, then you drop down to a weekly work plan so that there's accountability and a weekly check-in and people are making sure they're giving what others need as they hand off work down the line.
So three levels, planning kind of big, long, yearly, planning a bunch of stuff, and then planning a week at a time. When we in BIM define information delivery milestones, we're defining what is required and who's required to do that from a team perspective. We have all of this content that we could start creating and putting in the model, but what happens if all of those teams start putting all of that content in at the same time? Well, we know, and we've just seen one of the waste clashes.
It's just all dump work, right.
It just is all rework. So in order to combat that, it would be advantageous for teams to put their content into the model at the right time so that they don't have to move it.
Yeah.
And based on a priority structure, we have seen some incredible improvements. If we set the base and say, these things are foundational, and then these things, for example, gravity piping that need to have the slope that need to be fixed before some of the more flexible, maybe the cable tray that routes around something, it's able to really understand the sequence of events and how that can optimize things.
Yeah. The key is to do work first that releases other work.
Absolutely. And the principle is not starting everybody at the same time, but as you can see in these smaller bite-sized parts of the workflow, as we've planned out the milestones and the phases in the project, we can start teams at the right time and have their work always in place in the right place, rather than that iterative looping that is necessary because that hasn't been planned as a sequence. So how can we use pull planning as a technique to help us? Dan, do you want to talk?
Yeah, the key word is pull. What it means is you start at the end and pull backwards. You move from right to left in planning. Of course, you're going to execute from left to right. But in order to plan, you want to start with the milestone you're pulling from and say, what has to happen just before that, and then just before that, and then just before that? And in terms of designers, what information do I need to do my part of the design? Well, I want that to happen before me. And that's all we're doing here.
And so having a way of having a task that is represented maybe by a card, a sticky note in some way, we've seen much more powerful impact on the team when you have a visual. And then being able to use that, as you said, start at the end, plan backwards the sequence, put those tasks in order and write the notes and what I need in order to be able to do that.
Yep.
A lot of the time that plan is left on the wall.
Yeah, left on the wall, yeah.
Some of the challenge...
In design, it's not that easy.
Absolutely, yeah, because everyone's gone back to their own offices. Yeah. So there needs to be a way of capturing this. We have the ability to capture in a digital form that everyone has access to. And those tasks, those cards, can be represented as the period of time that they've just committed to, and also represented so that we can have the dependencies that they have asked for, and also the ability to have a checklist. So yeah, as we're going through this workflow, it's really important to be able to define that in electronic form as well, with dependencies, et cetera.
And the nice thing about this is it integrates what was scoped in Plannerly with the actual tasks. So we make sure we've got them all accounted for.
And so that's talking about the pull for the phase. When you start to work on those tasks on a weekly basis, what's different? How are you looking to then use the information and track and control that on a weekly basis?
On a weekly basis, you're no longer pulling. Now you're pushing. And sometimes you're really pushing. but the whole point of the weekly check-in and planning work on a weekly basis is accountability. Because you want to hold yourself accountable, but you especially want to hold other people accountable to deliver their promise to you when they said they would, so you can do your work on a timely basis. And that's how the weekly work plan works. And it's a way of keeping everybody informed. And if we didn't meet our commitment, why did we not? We need to figure out why.
And being able to manage those tasks in a simple Kanban board, we've seen the visual nature and the simple drag and drop and the filtering of just this week's tasks, removing a filter to be able to aggregate and see everybody's tasks, just so that you can go through that workflow, checking off what needs to be done and making sure, as Dan said, everything that was captured in the pull plan is then tracked and controlled and updated so that everyone knows where things are.
And Kanban's a great way for design teams.
Yeah. Absolutely. So we had a couple of case studies. They're very quick. One of them was a pretty fun exercise, which was a lab study. We had two teams, Team A, Team B, and they went through two exercises, one of them running just a traditional process where they got started, and then we evaluated the issues afterwards. And then the second one, and they switched over, the second one was when they actually had a communication about sequencing, and then ran in those mini phases. And it was astonishing. We saw a 73% reduction in the number of challenges, the issues that were resolved, that were needed to be resolved. So that was kind of a big aha moment. And Dan and I actually had the opportunity to run this in real life as well. The second case study was a multifamily design build project, which actually we had the perfect opportunity where we had two projects running at the same time, the same teams, and we could implement this workflow on one so we could really study. It doesn't really happen that often, so it was very, very lucky for us to get that opportunity. Dan, did you want to talk about some of the things?
The owner's hypothesis was that traditional design management, the SDDDCD, follows a large batching process, and that makes information build up and a lot of assumptions that are out of date, and misunderstandings then become a root cause for most of the waste in design and construction. I think that's a good thesis, that it jibes with my experience, and it results in incomplete and late design. And so the theory which worked out, as it turns out.
We didn't hit the 70-odd percent, but no. So 53% on a real live job and 2 months early, it was pretty pleasing.
Good. Yeah.
So we've talked about lean in design. We've talked about the waste that we're trying to attack. And then those two techniques, the phase planning, essentially from that milestone, and the weekly work planning. Let's look at a couple of tips just to get started, because I know that it's a challenge when it's something new. It's not always right and very easy for teams of lots of different companies to get together and yeah. achieve this. So Dan, how do we go about this? How do we start?
You pull in one person from each of the firms who've involved in the design, and you need really two people initially, the design lead and then a person with the authority to commit the resources for that organization. Because mm-hmm. As we start planning this, we're going to want to be able to staff in a way that we're able to meet the commitments that are made. And then you want someone who's a facilitator, knows the process, keeps the session running on time, and is focused on making sure everybody on the team provides input.
Perfect. And then where should we do this?
A big room. In fact, literally a big room is the best place. Some place where all the teams can attend. It may be a virtual big room if you've got people in different countries or on different coasts. Hopefully they can all come together at least for the initial session. You want a space that's at least no tables in the way, a big space in front of the wall, and you want a 16 to 20 foot wall that you can spread out plotter paper and put up the stickies that you were showing in the earlier video.
Great. And then any tips to get everyone prepared, get everyone
ready? Make sure
ready
that
for
the leadership decides on all of the milestones and defines them, what that means, what are the conditions of satisfaction. Identify separate areas of work that need to be pulled separately. If there are swim lanes, you know, civil may be different from interiors, for example, or building floors or mm-hmm. different areas. And clarify those conditions of satisfaction for major milestones. What does that actually mean?
I see something that I would like.
I hope print those electronic tags out of Planner. You need the visuals to facilitate the discussion.
Makes it much easier,
yeah. If you're running out of tags or you're not using it, definitely Post-its work great, but make sure you use Sharpies so that you can clearly read them. Some tape, some markers, some paper, and food.
Food.
Teams run on food.
Bring food and they will come. They will come.
Higher protein is better than sugary snacks.
Fantastic. So we've crammed a lot in. Thank you, Dan, for joining us. Maybe if you'd just like to summarize what we've learned today.
Sure. Identify who your customers are. They're not only the customer, but the people around you to whom you are a vendor of information. Identify non-value adds, things that are wasteful. Sequence your virtual build. Implement pull planning, pulling from right to left. Cultivate the right environment, which is collaborative, and get food. Everybody loves food.
Fantastic. Thank you, Dan. We really appreciate it. I know that there's been a barrage of questions.